And now, it's time for Switchblade Steve.
Hi, this is Switch. You know, when Mac asked me to pick out some of my favorite episodes from the show, I knew it was going to be difficult because of all the fascinating subjects we deal with from week to week. I was, however, able to come up with some of the ones that I think you'll find the most interesting and entertaining. So sit back and relax as we once again plunge into the mysteries of the cosmos on this special edition of Mack Maloney's Military X-Files.
Welcome back, everyone, to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney. In the studio with us is...
The great Juan-Juan.
The very famous Juan-Juan. Okay. Read your contract there.
All right. Sorry.
Okay. Very famous Juan-Juan is here. His nose buried in the...
Mothman.
What is that, anyway? Is that
the Mothman
stuff. Is that a tablet?
Stuff.
Is that a tablet?
Yep, it's an iPad.
Oh, it's an iPad. Okay.
iPad mini.
Okay. Hasn't blown up on you yet? Caught
nope.
on fire?
Nope. That's the Samsung Note 7 or whatever the heck it is.
Really, yeah?
Yep.
Probably not a real good rollout of that phone.
No, you know, those things happen, you know?
Yeah. Yeah,
can't. Sorry, can't take that on the plane.
Yeah, I know. And then they switch.
They don't like that.
They switch to an SUV and completely engulfed in flames, you know? And you, holy cow.
Oh, man.
Glad I have a flip phone. Anyway, on the...
ISIS bought a ton of them.
Did they really?
Yeah.
They might come with...
They thought, oh, wonderful feature built in.
See, now that's racist. Well, listen.
Sorry.
It's only I'll probably have to cut it out. Come in here and cut
okay.
it out.
Okay.
Maybe you get a free...
I'm
Galaxy
sorry.
Phone with every Toyota. See? You know what I mean?
Or every Pinto.
Anytime you see those characters on TV, they are always in Toyota trucks. Why?
Yeah, right. I asked that question to Cobra, I think, yeah. some time ago.
And what did he say?
He had no clue.
I mean, they just...
He said, well, you know what? I don't know what he said. I forget.
They must have had the corner in the market before, you know, in Iraq years ago or something. And anyway. On the phone with us, waiting anxiously.
Waiting for us to shut up.
Yeah, exactly. Switchblade, Steve Ward, just back from the Mothman, the big Mothman Festival down in West Virginia. How are you there? How you doing there, Switch?
I'm doing really good. I am having Mothman Festival withdrawals, however.
Uh-oh. And what does that involve?
Well, it's such a good time, and we really look forward to it every year that... You know, and one of the main things is it's like a family reunion. So
yes.
you see a lot of really good friends that sometimes you only see once a year.
Yes.
And it's really a real bummer when it's over.
It's fleeting.
It is.
It's like all good things, most good things.
Yep.
Fleeting.
It's like Christmas morning. It just
Fun
can't
is fleeting.
Last forever.
Christmas morning, if what?
After you open all your presents.
It can't last forever.
Oh, okay. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
A Christmas morning that can't last forever. One. That also writes.
That's right. Are we getting in a Zen kind of mood now, right now?
I don't know.
Yeah.
What's going on?
I feel a Zen coming on.
Was there Zen down there? Was there a lot of Zen down there?
Oh, a lot of Zen.
Where is that? Now, let's idea it on the map.
Okay. Point Pleasant, West Virginia.
Okay.
Is it's right on the Ohio River, right across from Gallipolis, Ohio.
Hmm.
I come down from South Central Michigan. And if I just kind of go kitty corner through Ohio from northeast to south, I'm sorry, northwest to southeast,
yes.
then you pretty much hit Gallipolis, cross the Silver Bridge, and then there's another bridge you cross, and you're right in Point Pleasant.
We should mention the bridge that collapsed a few years ago.
Yes, well, it's been, this is the Silver Bridge, but the original Silver Bridge was a little further upriver.
Okay, so
it actually came right out of Point Pleasant off of 6th Street. This is actually a little bit further south.
Okay, let me see. I'm going to try to give a very quick thumbnail of the whole Mothman thing, okay? And at the end, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, okay?
All right.
Want to keep score there, 1-1?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. He has a big pencil now. Well, anyway, okay.
This is your critique of the festival and you weren't there?
No. No, I'm going to tell the story, the Mothman story.
Oh, the Mothman story. Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah,
okay.
Right. Sorry.
Thanks for paying attention. What, do you play for the Yankees now? they got sleep in the field last night?
I thought you said you guys were the critique of the festival.
No.
Okay.
No. Thanks. Thanks for listening.
All right. Okay. Yes, tell us about the Mothman. Who the heck is the Mothman?
Okay, all right. Yeah, just one day, you know, years ago, and he'll fill in the date, people started seeing this figure that was like a little bit taller than a man,
mm-hmm.
not a head, but eyes, you know, yep. almost like an eagle's, you know, head
yep.
with huge wings. Okay.
Okay.
And
the eyes lit up or something.
Eyes
like
lit
that?
Up. Yep. Okay. And, but it was really big, you yep. know? So people would see it at this place called the TNT site, which is a place where they used to manufacture dynamite.
Mm-hmm.
And it would, there was instances where people would be on this road and this thing would start chasing them. And they'd be up to 90 miles an hour, and the freaking thing is flying right wow. over them and stuff, you know. So
going after the light, I assume, just like real moths
or something. Yeah. Hey, good point. All mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm. you know. And then you know it, there was a it happened a lot down there in this kind of certain amount of time. A lot of eyewitnesses.
Yep.
Brought a lot of investigators down there, which you know, as it turned out, a couple of really, more than a couple of really good investigators went down there, and to write about it, and then. I'm not saying it went away, but there was an incident where people saw this wingman. on sale everywhere, okay, where they saw Mothman at the top of this bridge, okay, and lots of people, I think there might even be a picture of him, mm-hmm. lots of people saying, oh, man, there's the Mothman. He's climbing up the top of this bridge, and then...
At Point Pleasant at the top of the bridge?
Yeah, yeah, okay. And a short time later, what was it, a year later?
Well,
it collapsed. It collapsed.
That may be the, wow. the part on the bridge may be a bit fanciful.
Oh, okay.
There were some rumors about that.
Yes.
But I'm not sure there was anything definitive. But you're right about the year. It was actually 13 months to the day wow. of that first major sighting where the two couples were chased on Route 62. That's 13 months later on December 15th
wow.
is when the Silver Bridge collapsed.
So, and how many people were on it? How many people were killed?
46 people were lost.
Really?
They recovered... 30-some bodies, I forget.
Oh, my goodness.
Some they never recovered, but, you know, certain people vanished. And, of course, the logical assumption was that they were on the bridge at the time. This was in really, really bitterly
cold. So nobody's making fun of that. No T-shirts about that.
No.
No.
Okay. What was it? Was that a traffic? You know, was it, you know, during the heavy traffic?
Very heavy. There were a problem with the lights on the Point Pleasant side. Sometimes the red light would just last forever, and it was common for people to run that light. But this was rush hour traffic. The bridge was completely filled with cars and trucks. And they determined it was the 13th eye bar that was had some kind of a defect, and it gave way.
Jeez.
And I don't know if anybody has seen the movie, but in the movie, the Richard Gere character has yes. all kinds of time to warn people off the bridge, you know,
mm-hmm.
and saves all kinds of lives. But in reality, it's just like dominoes falling over.
Oh,
there were some people that were, there was one lady that a friend of mine knows that was right there, and she backed up just in time to miss falling into the river.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, that's just... Yeah,
it's
that's
gone in an instant.
It's like nightmares, you know, going over high bridges and you're up there. It's like...
Is there a memorial to that? Is that included in the hayride tour?
Well, we don't really go there. You see, a lot of people... think this Mothman apparition or whatever was a harbinger or caused the bridge collapse.
Okay.
Well, I'm not sure about that, but the thing is that the Mothman and the UFO sightings and so forth, this all happened at that point in time. So whether there's any kind of real connection or not, you know, in space and time, it's connected,
yes.
but geographically. So it's always going to be in people's minds, you know, that it happened at the same time.
Right. It has to be
connected. The hayride is definitely, I do a tour in the TNT area. That's the area where the Mothman was first seen.
Yes.
There's three of us that do kind of a classic. It's sort of like a haunted hayride, but we definitely try and keep that light and a lot of fun.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Now, is there drinking allowed during the hayride?
Well, sometimes a little bit late in the evening, you can tell the bar crowd starts to drift in, you know, a little more boisterous.
Okay, yeah, hey, you know, let's have a couple, you know, about six or seven Jack and Gingers. Yeah. Take a hayride.
Three cheers to the Mothman.
Yeah, right. I think I'd go for the seventh instead of that. But anyway, hey, listen, I'm sure it's a lot of fun. So what are the things that you would do to scare people?
Well, as soon as you... You start to get into the opening of where the TNT area is. You are met by the dreaded Men in Black,
mm-hmm.
and it's a family deal, so they're not too dreaded. You know,
yes.
they're more like a little bit more like the Keystone Cops.
Yes,
but
please tell us they weren't driving golf carts this year.
Yeah, well, see, that's Brent Raines who who does Alternate Perceptions magazine, he came down last year.
Okay.
And he said, he's the one that observed that the economic downturn got to the men in black because now they're driving golf carts instead of black Cadillacs. But the thing that happened to halfway through the night was the battery died in the golf cart, so they had to go on foot. So these guys were pretty persistent.
And now they dressed, what are they dressed as? The long black spy coat?
Oh, they
coat,
got the fedora, the black suit and tie and everything.
Wow.
And they threaten you about going into this government area. And what I do is we have a lot of banter back and forth. These guys are absolutely hilarious. Mm. You never know what they're going to do on the return trip. And
now, when you say that they, what was your quote just now? They try to prevent you from going in there?
Yes. Yeah. Well, they'll tell you that you stop. This is a restricted area.
Nothing to see here.
You're being pulled in by a tractor. You know, a guy hired you to pull in.
Do they slap you around?
Really stop.
Hey, would they take one person out and slap them around? You know, make an example of them? You should add that to the act.
Oh, go ahead.
That sounds like a lot of fun.
Yes. So what were some of the things that would they come out and would they kind of accost people as the weird kind of blank eyed three men in black
costume,
yes.
And there's a few more men in black sprinkled back there. There's a couple guys in hazmat suits that apparently have a dead alien on their hands, and there's all kinds of smoke from the smoke machine, which I guess is supposed to be radiation or something like that. They've done different things different years. One year they had a really cool flying saucer that would raise and lower. It's quite an engineering feat there. And it just varies. And frankly, it's a matter of budget and volunteers, Sure. So
how many people would you say attended?
This was phenomenal. I've never seen it like this. At least 10,000 people, probably between 10 and 15,000.
Wow. I thought you were going to say 3,000 or 4,000.
You could hardly move from one end to the other.
Holy.
But I have to tell you, though, on the ride, that the highest is the flyover of the Mothman with the red glowing eyes and everything.
Tell us how that went.
Pardon me?
How did it go? I mean, everything work all right? Or did it break down halfway?
Well, there was one pass. See, I know, John. As a matter of fact, I go down early to help run the cords, and they got this ingenious setup to fly the Mothman, to pull him back, and then to
fly them over
sound effects.
Over the visitors, over the hayride visitors, the Mothman.
Oh, yeah, right over. Just, and it actually, you think it's not going to surprise anybody, but it does. Every once in a while, it really gets them pretty good.
I'll bet.
And the kids absolutely love it. Yeah. But one pass, they were going by, and they had some kind of a technical problem. So Mothman was kind of flying backwards.
Oh, so he could do that too.
I yelled, I said, "Hey, we want our money back. Mothman doesn't fly backwards."
Yeah.
So at the last minute, the guy driving the tractor slowed down a little bit, and John and Tim got it together, and we got the Mothman flying just right.
Oh, I get it.
And everybody on board clapped. So
has to be with speed. Has to do with speed and relative motion.
Relative motion and a lot lift. Of luck.
When he
was, a lot of experienced stagehands running the. Yeah. It sounds like theater props, rock and roll props, things like that happen.
Yeah, John and Tim are the unsung heroes. They're stuck back there in this little corner. It's what's called the old acid plant. If you've ever seen an old
black
and white
TNT photograph. Plant and an acid plant.
Yeah, we have seen some
in
acid
this town.
Plants. Yeah, okay, but it all depends on camera.
The TNT area was a huge complex where they, constructed, explosives for World War II. And if you ever look at any of the old black and white photographs, there were plants and power plants and buildings. And it's just nothing like it looks today.
Wow. All those people on acid assembly.
I'd like to see that.
But back to your question about the number of attendees. One of the factors was, I don't know how many of the audience has ever seen the TV show Mountain Monsters. It's where the hillbilly guys are running around chasing Bigfoot and lizard demons and all kinds of stuff.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's a, in quotes, reality show that is everybody, most people know that it's a mockumentary just for fun.
Yeah. Okay.
And that it's all scripted. But I've met these guys a couple times at different conferences.
Mm-hmm.
And they're great guys.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, they drew in hundreds of people. Wow. The line, their little section was a little bit down the block, which was good because we were already pretty crowded.
Yes.
And they had at least at one point, a buddy of mine estimated roughly 600 people in line going around the block just to see these guys.
Wow. So they got a little gig going there, these guys.
But now in the core area, you have the people like Nick Redfern, Stan Gordon.
Oh, yeah. Very famous.
Lorne Coleman, Rosemary Ellen Guiley, and there's a particular section where they have their tables.
Yes.
And they'll sell their books and their wares and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And then down the street is the theater where the speakers, both Saturday and Sunday, they have their chance to speak and give their lectures.
Nice looking theater, too.
Man.
Yeah, nice old theater.
It was a lot cooler than the UFO festival in Exeter.
Yeah, how many people were there? 300?
Yeah, I thought about 500 or so.
500, yeah. But 10,000?
Yeah.
Ooh, wow.
Yeah, it was just absolutely, it was mind-numbing. We've never seen it like that.
Right. What did the bars look like? I mean, I went to this one UFO festival, and the bar was always pretty crowded, you could say.
Sure, I could imagine that.
In the hotel where it was taking place. What was the bar scene down there? Did you see anything going on?
Well, I didn't really hang in the bar scene too much. I don't know how many bars there are around there. It's not a dry county, but the restaurants in the area had a rough time. I mean, there's a lot of course, there were a lot of other food vendors set up too.
Right.
They even had a Ghostbusters team. They had a giant Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
That's funny.
They had one of these things where the kids can what do they call it? A pull line where you climb the thing and you.
Good.
You slide down to the street.
Yes.
Zip cord.
Yeah. So they had all that, all the kind of state fair kind of stuff as well. But the really interesting stuff was the main draw, which are people like Stan Gordon and Nick Redfern and so forth.
So how many people live there when the festival isn't happening?
I don't think I know it's not a super big town, Point Pleasant. I don't know how many thousands of people are actually there.
Maybe two or three, maybe.
Maybe double that.
Okay,
I'm going to guess.
So it's not a big area. So, wow, when 10,000 people come to town, where do they stay? You know what I mean? Where do they eat and stuff? Are there facilities?
They stay at the Low Hotel.
The Low Hotel?
Well, there's only so many rooms are available there. That they rent out.
Yes.
So a lot of people stay across the river. There's quite a few places. I stay across the river in Gallipolis. The Lowe's prices skyrocket during the festival.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm afraid that I go to a nice little mom and pop place that's actually off the grid right in Gallipolis.
So, off the grid meaning there's no electricity?
Meaning people won't, if they're looking for a place online, they're not going to find them.
Oh, I get it.
It's not on Travelocity.
It's my private place, damn it. So.
Is it like a diner? There's diner food?
No, it's just a little mom and pop hotel.
I see. Oh, okay. Oh, I love diner food.
I like motel, especially when the M isn't lit up. It says hotel.
But we have the Harris Steakhouse, aka the Mothman Diner, and that's right in town. But you better get in there early for breakfast, or during the day, it's just going to be.
What do they serve at the Mothman Diner?
It's some Mothman.
Well,
Mothman
they got some fare. Kind of all the places in town have some kind of Mothman something. A Mothman burger or. Mothman latte or whatever. Everybody capitalizes.
Mothman latte.
It doesn't ring. You know what I mean? It doesn't ring. The Mothman.
Yeah, that's a good marketing exercise for somebody.
And now there's also the Mothman Museum, which is superbly done. They were in a smaller building across the street a few years ago, and now they've got a nicer building. Jeff Wamsley, who is the co-founder of the festival and the curator of the museum, his daughter Ashley she works all year on this, and they have excellent merchandise in there, and they have the whole history laid out of the Mothman and the folklore and newspaper articles and photographs and so forth.
Listen,
and that line to get in there was astronomical as well.
Commerce, baby. In the next, in the 20 seconds we have left, did any of the speeches or anything that you heard down there, come to some conclusion on this? Or was there any, new evidence or anything earth-shaking?
Not really. I think people are, have different ideas and probably as mystified as they were from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But in the few seconds we have closing, We've got to get a Mack Maloney X-Files contingent to the Mothman Festival someday.
All expenses paid, by the way.
Yes. Okay. Who said that?
Well, it's free to get in, so I'll cover that.
Okay. All right. So, Steve, we put Steve down.
I'll drive. I'm cool with that.
No, we should get an RV.
We should get an RV.
Jump.
Black RV.
A black RV? Oh, yeah. With tinted windows.
Yep.
That'd be excellent. Put antennas and stuff on top. Be great. Switchblade Steve Ward. Just back from the Mothman Festival down there in Point Pleasant, West Virginia. And thanks for your report, and thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks a lot. That was
my
great.
Pleasure.
As every week. What's next week? Any idea?
I think maybe we'll pick up with the mysterious occurrences in Dubbed Wales.
Oh, that's right.
In 1977.
Someone wrote me the other day saying, hey, what happened to that Wales story? Because we kind of lost it there last week.
Yeah, we did.
Oh, it's a good one. It might even be worth two parts, depending on how much time we spend on it.
Super duper. Switchblade Steve Ward, thank you very much for joining us. We'll talk to you next week.
All right.
Next Switch. Be safe.
Good night, guys.
Be safe. Well, that's it, Juan. That's the show.
Wow, I'm exhausted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
a lot going on.
For some reason, yes. We're going to have to drown our sorrows somewhere.
I could have more fun like Rob and Switch.
They do have a lot of fun.
Commander. I got to get out in the field.
There's something about, you know, roaring through the
can
desert.
Can I co-host from the field? Yeah, I get. Yeah.
And seeing the stars and all that stuff.
I know it. Yeah. Who knows what you're going to see when you're staring at the stars.
That's what I mean.
I was looking at the full moon the other night, and I'm going, I thought I saw something cross the full moon, but it was going up and kind of stopped and then, you know.
Really?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
It was the leaves on the tree, a branch.
Oh, really?
Kind of
sticking
out.
Oh, okay. All right. Hey, maybe
kind of a rogue branch, and it kind of cut my line of sight and was creating a.
But that was, maybe that was nature's way of sending you a message about something. Which is
it was.
Get stronger glasses.
Then get to bed.
Yeah. Hey, Juan, did you go to the beach a lot as a kid?
Yes, Mac, I sure did.
I have a feeling like as a youth you were like the 90-pound weakling and that the bullets used to kick sand in your face.
As a matter of fact, they did. I mean, I tried to pump iron back then, but I'd get pooped pretty quickly.
Oh, my God. Look at you two girly men.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
What are you doing here?
I'm here to make sure you read the ad copy for this fabulous new workout product called SEX that I can't endorse, but I'm sure works wonderfully.
Hey, Arnold, what was that thing with you and the maid?
Ugh, just do the ad.
Yeah, man, nailing the maid, that's a little fringy.
That's it. I'm going to turn you into two Vienna pretzels.
Cobra, save us!
I'd be glad to, gentlemen. What the boys are trying to say is, this is a new energy drink that can give you the extra endurance you need to get through your daily workout.
Yeah.
It's called SEX, for Strength Energy Accelerator. It comes easy to use. Just mix a scoop with water and drink 30 minutes before you start your workout, and you find you can last longer and feel all around better after finishing your regime.
Yeah.
The mix comes in many different flavors. Of course, my favorite is passion fruit.
Me too.
And it contains all the essentials you need to get over the top, whether you're trying to add muscle and bulk or just maintain your current physique.
You could look like me.
That's SEX, workout dietary supplement, available only through Cadillo USA. Visit CadilloUSA.com for more details. That's CadilloUSA.com and get some sex today.
Hey, what's going on in here?
Pistol Pete,
what are you doing here?
I told you guys, no partying in the studio. What are all these dumbbells doing here?
Hey, just because you own this place doesn't mean you can call me a dumbbell.
Oh, yeah?
Kick his ass, Pete.
Come on, I'm right here.
SEX workout powder, available only through CadilloUSA.com. Read instructions carefully before using.
Back, everyone, to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight. The very famous Juan-Juan is here.
How's it going so far?
I don't think your microphone's on. How about that? Come on. Hang on. Technical error. First
Thank
one
you
ever.
Very much.
There you go. Okay. Get that level right.
All right.
Juan-Juan is here. He's dressed tonight like a very suave
lumberjack.
Yeah, going for the lumberjack.
Tis the season for lumberjacking.
Is it really?
Yep.
Is it? The middle of winter?
Yeah.
Really?
Sure.
Okay. I didn't know that. I didn't know lumberjacks had a season, but I suppose they must have.
Right? Yeah, well, it's all year long, actually.
For all the lumberjacks out there listening.
If you want to get wood, you got to come to me.
Geez, come on. Now, come on. Now, I'm just going to cut that out for aesthetic reasons.
All right. Aesthetic reasons.
Also with us is from the undisclosed location, and also in, how should I say it, in costume, undercover, on the, you know, how would you put his wardrobe tonight? I am talking about Commander Cobra, of course. Where is, oh. Cobra, please.
I'm a seasonally adjusted to the full moon.
See now.
No, I didn't look at my chart. Is it really the full moon tonight or right now or what?
Through the beautiful radio.
Look at my face.
I can't see him. How come we can't see him there, Ron? We are on the radio, but let's talk visual.
It's just as well we can't see him.
Yeah, okay. All right, but he's all dressed up. He dressed up for this. He's dressed as a wolf man. We should see him anyway.
No.
Also joining us from the Bowl of Flakes up there in Battle Creek, Michigan, is Switcherino Steve Ward. He's with us. Hello, Steve.
Hi.
Oh, wow. He kind of sounds a little...
He was asleep at the switch. But,
right, yeah, and then we startled him.
Okay. That was just a dramatic pause.
Oh, okay, all right. We need a lot of those because we are on radio. Anyway, how are you doing tonight?
Listen, I'm doing so well that we're going to have the... people that write the thesaurus reconvene so that they can come up with more words, more synonyms for awesome.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Writing his own material now.
You know it.
All right, Steve, hold on.
He's going to be working for Oxford pretty soon.
There you go. Or Vegas, somewhere in the Vegas. That was great. I like it. I like the rhythm of that. You delivered that. Just like a stand-up comedian, but I can't...
Right off the cuff.
I just love last week's, which is Just This Side of Awesome. It's a great title, you know?
I'll have to write these down so I don't keep repeating myself.
I just listen to the show.
No, that's what we're here for.
Okay, anyway.
Oh, okay.
Cobra, what's the matter with your camera for our listening audience?
You only pay me for one set of shots at the beginning of the show.
All right. I should have known.
If you want to renegotiate on the air, we can do that.
All okay. Right. Talk to Pistol
Pete. I don't blame him.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, so Switch, you're doing well and up there in Battle Creek, up where they make all the cereals. Okay. Did we already ask you what kind of cereal you eat? Do you eat cereal in the morning?
I'm more of a donut guy, but my doctor.
Oh, fuck, yes. aren't we
you
all?
Know.
I like this guy.
Donuts, I mean, it doesn't get any better.
You're right. I've been trying to get off the donuts for years. I just can't.
I know. I love donuts, but
there was a time, Steve, where I get a cup of coffee and get like four of the raised, raised glazed donuts and just pound them down like peanuts.
Wow. Yeah. Do they have Dunkin' Donuts up there?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, they're everywhere. They started here, but. The thing about them, and I know we'll never get them as a sponsor, is do you eat their donuts now?
I do, but they're just not as good as they used to be. Not even close.
They're not as good as they used to be. They used to be more.
I liked it when they made them on premise in the stores.
Yeah, right. Yeah, now
guys covered with powered sugar, and you know.
Yep.
Time to make the donuts.
It's also the dietary changes that our government forced them to put into place.
Yeah, trans fat stuff.
Changed the taste of that.
Exactly.
Somewhere along the line, it was the government's fault.
You know, the double chocolate donut is still okay.
There's no conspiracy. That is hard fact.
You go into a Dunkin' Donuts now and you have to look for the donuts because they sell everything else. You know, sandwiches and milkshakes.
You know, there's still Mr. Donut in China.
Are they? Really? Yeah, Mr. Donut.
I have a picture of my daughter did some marketing for. DD and had to go to China, and she took a picture of herself in front of a Mr. Donut
also
shop.
Known as DD.
Right. Yeah, or D squared.
Yeah. There's, this is really local, but there's a couple donut places within 50 miles of here that are like excellent homemade donuts.
Yeah, I gotta hit those places.
A place up in Maine, there's a place down in Saugus, Mass. So they would give you a reason to go to Saugus, Mass. Very inside.
I'm done. You have to give me the name of that place.
I will. Switch, what are we talking about tonight? I was intrigued by your message. It had Loch Ness in it and also UFOs.
Well, it's there's quite a bit of things going on there at Loch Ness, not just the classic Nessie. Back in 1973, fall of 1973, I had a chance to visit Loch Ness. I'd mentioned before in another program, we did the Falkirk Triangle, that I had been able to backpack through parts of Europe and Great Britain. And so now I had read just a few months before a book by F.W. Holliday called The Great Orm, that's O-R-M, of Loch Ness. Now, orm was just an ancient word for worm. And that's what a lot of these, the ancient, when you go back and talk about the water horse, the kelpie and so forth, a lot of the legends of these creatures that are supposed to inhabit these different lakes and lochs were described as kind of a giant worm or serpent. Well, I had read this book by Holiday. Now, as he went on in his thinking about this creature, at first he was absolutely convinced it was some kind of an unknown flesh and blood creature. But as time went on, he changed. Now, he didn't write this second book called The Dragon and the Disc till later. But I went to Scotland, standing on the shores of Loch Ness, with this great, this really really well-written book. He thought, you know, how many people envision Nessie as a plesiosaur, right?
Okay.
A classic. A plesiosaur, the classic long-necked dinosaur with the the fins. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
But that doesn't make any sense, even assuming that there is something alive in the loch. A plesiosaur, according to paleontologists, would have been a air-breathing creature. So if the loch was populated with several plesiosaurs, we'd be seeing them a lot more often. You know, even if they had survived into this age, which is possible, but also adjusted to the extreme, you know, extreme different temperatures that would exist today than did back then. So that was a really great experience. It was a beautiful day. Loch Ness itself is something like 22 miles long, about a mile wide. I guess it runs along some kind of a fault line there. Mm-hmm. And it was a really cool experience. We went down with a group of people. We followed the Foyers River down to the loch. Mm-hmm. And of course, I didn't see anything, but it was a pretty interesting experience. Now, sometime before that, I had read, there's another researcher, I'll get back to Holiday later because he's really interesting, but Tim Dinsdale is well known. He was one of these guys that would set up his tripod on the edge of the loch and just spend, you know, weeks and months there with his camera ready mm-hmm. to catch something. Well, he, and I may have even seen him when I took the bus down to the Foyers. From Inverness, where I stayed at a youth hostel, I saw some guy on the edge of the loch with his camera all set up. I have no idea if it was him or not, but mm-hmm. somebody was out there keeping a vigil.
Right.
Now, he, on April 23rd, 1960, he'd been, you know, out there for several weeks, didn't see anything. Then he gets in his car, drives through Upper Foyers, the little town there, little village. Mm-hmm. He spots in the water something dark moving across the water, jumps out. It's about 4,000 feet away in the distance. He gets his binoculars out, sees this thing moving. He gets his 16-millimeter camera out and starts filming. Mm-hmm. He said it had kind of the contour and color of the American buffalo. And you know how you've seen these classic photographs or drawings of sometimes a serpent neck, but sometimes just these one, two, or three humps that
yes.
are moving in the water.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, he saw one of these. He said it was approximately maybe 5 feet out of the water. It's very hard to tell because it was so far away. Mm-hmm. But what he noticed was there was it left a wake behind it, but no prop wash.
Hmm.
Now, I don't know exactly how these events unfolded, but for some reason, the RAF, and they have this Joint Air Reconnaissance Intelligence Center.
Okay.
And which their normal focus is going to be on analyzing footage of Russian fighter planes and so forth.
Right.
But they analyzed this 16-millimeter footage of several minutes long. And it's very interesting with the conclusions they came up with.
Mm-hmm.
They also noticed that, you know, it left a wake, but no prop wash. It was moving at about 10 miles an hour, okay. about 5 feet or so out of the water, this one particular hump. Oh, by the way, as he saw this move away, it seemed to slowly submerge off mm-hmm. into the distance and mm-hmm. then disappear. It wasn't just that it went out of sight because of the distance.
But all I could see is the hump. Said, no head, no tail, no nothing, just the hump.
No, this is just this hump okay. For just, this one particular
just the hump.
Case. Yes. I knew that was coming.
Yep.
Another hit.
Oh, boy.
So here you've got this thing moving about 10 miles per hour, about 5 feet out of the water. And their conclusion was, when they didn't say this is some kind of a creature, but they said probably animate.
Oh, wow.
So you draw your own conclusions. Well, here's the, you know, the RAF highly specialized team that
right.
did this.
Probably animate, meaning it moves, or it's a special effect. What do you mean by that?
That's alive.
Okay.
Right?
Right. Yeah, right. I think that was the implication.
Okay.
So
was Loch Ness connected to the ocean at one time? It's not connected now, right?
I think they hypothesized that it was. They believed that it may have been at one time and then closed off with all the changes in the geology.
Right, yeah.
Now, Holiday, for the longest time, Loch Ness was not easy. There wasn't easy access to Loch Ness. But in 1933, for the first time, they built a road that went all the way from Inverness to, I think it was Fort Augustus. And that's when you started getting more traffic going along the lot, because prior to that, even though there was a road nearby, you couldn't see the lock in a lot of parts of this road. So people weren't really, you know, exposed to the waters that much.
Mm-hmm. So the more and people that came, the more sightings there were then, right?
Right. Okay. And it was, I think I've got it here, 1933, there was the first sighting, a Hugh Gray. He took this famous picture, very grainy, very hard to see anything, but it was November 12, 1933, just for reference,
right.
was kind of like the first modern-day report and sighting of Nessie.
Right.
But Holiday, like that, we've talked about certain UFO researchers that they looked at the UFO enigma as something very solid, very nuts and bolts, something you can touch.
Yes, right.
Well, as time went on, Holiday noticed some very strange things about the lock and about the Nessie.
Mm-hmm.
People that – there was one – he had one sighting himself where he's talking to some people that are camping near him on the lock.
Mm-hmm.
And the moment he sees this thing break the water – and let me go back for a minute here. Holiday was a skilled angler. He wrote several books on fishing and so forth.
Okay.
So, and he had studied wildlife in places like Iraq, India, Africa. And he wasn't fearful about any of this stuff. He always said there's something very unsettling about the lock and Loch Ness. And he's quoted as saying, after sunset, Loch Ness is not a water by which to linger.
Wow, okay.
Now,
sounds like the Charles River.
His first sighting, I think, was in 62. He was just a young boy when these things started to be seen, and he was fascinated by it. Something large and black broke the surface about 3 feet out of the water, and the impression was you can kind of see the agitation of the water underneath, that it could have been anywhere from 30 to 40 feet long.
Whoa.
And he developed this initially giant slug theory, because the plesiosaur didn't make any sense. But this is back when he thought that it was some kind of a real animal.
Yes.
Let's see. But things get really weird. I want to divert.
I'm still thinking about the giant slug.
Yeah, I just wrote this down. This is the name of our band.
Yeah.
Forget about killer. What was the other one? Suicide drones. It's gonna be the giant slugs. Go ahead, please.
Well, he collected. There was people that saw UFOs in this area, even a landed UFO with occupants inside. This guy was a Sundberg. He was a native Swede, and he. Got kind of turned around and lost at one point around the lock. He saw this cigar-shaped craft of some sort in a clearing. He saw these occupants, which looked like they had some kind of diver suit. At first, he thought they had some kind of a submarine or something, and they were inspecting the lock.
Mm.
But then the thing took off straight up in the air, 60 feet, and then took off over the lock.
Wow.
People would see orbs. These strange orbs flying around the lock.
Right.
And there was also, like I said, there was the camera malfunction. People would become ill. Holiday investigated several lakes in Ireland as well, he and other people. And if you read the literature, you'll find that you look at lakes and lochs all over the place, Ireland, Sweden, Canada.
Yes, yeah,
sure. And so many of these places have their own local legends of their own little creature, you know, sort of wannabe Nessie.
Right.
And
yes, sure.
He also found that and sometimes when people were investigating this area, they would become ill. And then when they stopped the investigation, that the illness, the pain would go away.
Wow.
Very, very strange. But before I go on with this other, oh, by the way, that the Swede, the Sundberg that had this encounter, it from then on, it was kind of one of these classic UFO encounters. He goes back to Sweden, and there was an outbreak of poltergeist phenomena that he experiences in his house. He also starts to be harassed by a man in black type.
Yes. Man, I love stories like this. This is just, you know, this whole idea that maybe it's all connected. I love that.
But just to confuse the issue more, you know how we've talked about this before. Some aspects seem to be paranormal and something you can't physically touch.
Yep.
But yet this thing breaks the water. It it leaves a wake. You know, people see, they can't see through it. I mean, it looks like it's physically real.
Right.
Well, there's a very few recorded land sightings of this thing, which are absolutely fascinating. Actually, this was in July 22nd, 1933. This is actually before the big classic sighting that started it all. And this guy, this Mr. and Mrs. George Spicer, this guy was the well-respected tailor, Todd House and Company, you know, not just some average radio talk show guy. Just
this guy had credentials.
Wait a minute.
you know what?
He had bona fides.
Right. Bona fides. Right. Juan speaking Italian. Go ahead, please.
They're on this new road that's opened up, and between foyers and doors, they're heading south. All of a sudden, Mrs. Spicer screams. About 600 feet in front of them was this big thing that came out of the bushes at the edge of the road. It looked, the first thing they saw was what looked like a large trunk, like an elephant's trunk.
Yes.
Spicer is quoted as calling it hideous, an absolute affront against nature.
Wow.
Now,
a joke there somewhere. I just don't know.
Definitely screaming to be recognized. Okay.
Now, this is characteristic. The way in which the creature moved across the road, and this is I'm quoting from another well-known Nick Redfern.
Yes,
has written a book called Nessie, and he's the first one in decades that have revisited the paranormal aspects of Nessie.
Oh, cool.
But he's covered every other aspect of it. It's an excellent book.
Right.
Well, according to him, he describes the Spicers, the way they saw this creature. The way it moved across the road seemed to be a sort of lumbering, like in a series of odd jerking motions.
How did it move? Did it have legs or not? It was just moved on its belly?
No legs.
Like a seal?
More like a giant worm.
Oh, wow. A giant worm. Yes. Okay. Yes.
And there's another sighting. Actually, this one happened a year before, but didn't come to light until the 90s. Lieutenant Fordyce, he and his fiance were in the same general area, at least somewhere along that road. And right in front of them, they described something that was kind of a weird cross between a camel and a horse.
Hmm.
It had some kind of hump on its back.
Another,
small head at the end of a long neck. Hump. Same kind of thing.
Yes.
He jumped out of his car to run after it. You could see that it was gray in color. And, you know, he never really got a good look at it. Didn't
right.
really say how it was.
You realize what the British referred to a camel as, correct?
What?
The A camel is a horse that was built by committee in Britain.
Oh, wow. There you go. Okay, interesting.
And there's even another one that has kind of the same general characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
So, you wonder, there's some difference in the description. But then you go back to the ancient belief about the water kelpie. the water horse.
Mm-hmm.
This was a shapeshifter.
Yes.
They believed that this thing would sometimes take the form of a horse and would grab unsuspecting individuals and pull them into the lock. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it would even take on the vestige of a man.
Yes.
And sometimes it would always be something wrong about this person, something a little bit off that would if you were to be alert, would give it away.
Yes.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say it's a little close to home, but I should say I had to do some research once for stuff that happens in England that, you know, these kind of stories and like this. You think the book was like this? It was like an encyclopedia.
Really?
It was unbelievable how many things like this, you know.
Was it something about the geography or what was?
It's very strange. I didn't think it's an old place. It's a real ancient place.
Yeah.
Or something, you know, but there are monsters that literally, you know, hide in the bulrushes, for instance. You know, and if you get too close, they'll, you know, pull you in, and they have, like, you know, eyewitness accounts to it, and just crazy, crazy, crazy stuff. And I think it's been around for so long they accumulate. You know,
it's creatures of the spirit world from all those antique civilizations.
I said last week, I've seen pictures of stuff where people see like black panthers and stuff. Mm. You know, roaming the countryside, and they take pictures of them, and it's like, where did this thing come from? You know, and they're not just, you know, these things are like big friggin' cats. Go ahead, please, Steve.
Now, Holiday had written his second book, The Dragon and the Disc, where he lays out his theories about the paranormal aspects. Even goes back into ancient carvings where you see the serpent motif and the disc. And he talks about the disc culture.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting. If you've ever seen, you know, the Serpent Mound, the famous Serpent Mound in southern Ohio?
Mm-hmm, sure.
I don't know if you've ever, if you look at that from the air, it looks exactly like a Nessie.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
It's got the humps. It's got the long neck. It's just, it's really, really intriguing when you look at it from that aspect. Now, he met up with a gentleman named Reverend Donald Ormond.
Okay.
Ormond had written a book. He firmly believed that these creatures were evil. They were supernatural. And Holiday went with him when this guy went to Loch Ness and performed an exorcism.
Yeah.
He went to four different corners of the lock to perform the ceremony, casting out these evil beings or whatever.
Evil beings out of the Loch Ness area?
Out of Loch Ness.
Well,
and then he went to the fifth point. He said he had to go into the center of the lock to perform the ceremony again.
So wow.
Do that.
He's a real trooper. Yeah, go ahead.
You know, be okay on shore with the car running in the background.
Yeah, right.
Ye of little faith, apparently.
So did it work?
Well, no, because Ness kept showing up. But here's where it really gets weird.
Yes.
They were staying. There's a couple, the Careys, that had a sort of a motorhome there that they were staying in while they were doing all this stuff.
Yes.
And there was, at one point, and this is when Holiday was there, they experienced this like a loud rustling sound outside. Three really violent sounding thuds, but they didn't know where they came from or what it was hitting. Through the window, Holiday could see kind of a pyramid shaped column of smoke.
Yes.
Then the lady, Mrs. Carey, saw a white beam of light shoot through the window, hit Holiday right in the forehead.
Wow.
He didn't see the light.
Light.
Holiday always had this sense of foreboding around the lock, but he couldn't explain what was going on. But
I just want to make sure we've established the fact that Mr. Holiday did not see the light.
He did not. This woman saw it come through.
How many times in a married situation has the woman seen the light? And it's been reported by her that the man has not seen the light. I just want to make that observation.
Cobra's advice. Cobra's couple's advice. Do you want me to, I'm trying to pass Juan a note here, but okay. He's writing me back a note once again. Lyrics.
Steve, please continue. I'm sorry to me to.
It's because you have all that.
It was a true observation, though.
Let me just ask you a couple questions real quick. All right. First of all, didn't someone, and I don't want to put you in the spot, but I think we talked about this off air. Didn't someone bring dolphins to the lock at one point, and they just figured, you know, dolphins could just, you know, zoom in on this thing? Or did I dream that somewhere?
I think you dreamed it. I thought they were saltwater animals.
I've got a little bit on sonar.
You can get fresh water dolphins.
I don't know about the dolphins.
Okay. All right. All right. I'm going to look into it. I think for some reason, some guy from New Hampshire did it. And, you know, figuring, well, these things will go, like, right to it. And they didn't completely not find something, but, you know, there was nothing definitive. And when you go to Loch Ness, as you did, can you just go up to the place? Or is there, let's say, an admission fee or a toll or something?
No, there's nothing like that. Trying to remember. I'm sure I must have taken a train up to. I don't know if I took the train or but there's some areas where it's more convenient to take the bus. But Inverness is a nice little town. I stayed at the hostel there, and just to get down to the lock, we took a bus. I met up with, like I say, a few
Mack,
people.
Yes,
I have some breaking news here that I'd like to share
okay,
with you.
Okay, here we go.
If I could. Just a second, please.
Just hot off the wire.
A world-famous researcher who tried to find Loch Ness Monster with dolphins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let me give you a quick rundown here. The obituary of Robert H. Rhines logs enough accomplishments. Yes. MIT grad. We discussed earlier in the show what the mascot of that fine institution.
Another MIT grad.
He attempted to put either bottlenose dolphins in, it appears.
Yes, yes.
He wanted to enlist them. A pair of bottlenose dolphins, which are commonly seen at the entrance of the river Inverness, and tried to do the search recovery.
Wow.
And
okay.
He had absolutely no danger or discomfort or strain on the dolphins operating as we proposed in Loch Ness. After they were trained, the dolphins were slated to go through a period of acclimation in the cold water. And according to documents, Rhines and cohorts, high probability of a conspirator to plan to lead the British government. So there is conspiracy in this. The Society for Prevention of Cruelty Animals of Scotland was clearly unhappy with this.
I'm sure the dolphins get two in the hat, as they said, once it was over, right?
The dolphins had died. One of the two dolphins died in the attempt. It was organically sound and died of unknown causes. Mack, I believe this is a separate show that I need to investigate.
Okay, yeah, let's do it. So we'll call the Lock Show. So it's free admission, let's say, all right? Because I know there are some places, like in New Hampshire, for instance, there's some lake monster or up in New York, and it's free admission, but you know everything around it is, you know, all the doohickeys and the, you know, stuff. Actually, Juan, I just want you to do me a favor, if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I want you to read, if you don't mind, the last three. This is the Police Synchronicity 2. Their song, hit song, great song. The last three lines before the verse. Please read those in your best Shakespearean accent, please. One, please.
Okay, from Synchronicity 2 by the Police. Many miles away, there's a shadow on the door of a cottage on the shore of a dark Scottish lake.
Yeah. See, actually wrote about the land sightings
Up ahead it says, is a humiliating kick in the crotch.
Oh, wait a minute.
Many miles away, something crawls to the surface of a dark Scottish loch.
Synchronicity, too. Great, great song.
Yep.
Great album.
It is.
Absolutely.
Yep. Anyway, Switch Arena, thank you.
Yes.
So,
to finish up.
Yes, please, the punchline.
Okay. The next morning, Holiday steps outside of this they call it a caravan, okay? And he's looking at the slope that leads down to Loch Ness. He sees a man standing there dressed entirely in black, staring at him about 30 yards away. He had this real sensation of malevolence, something very evil. So he walked toward it and then walked past him, trying to see if there's any reaction. He turns around, and this thing has vanished. A year later, 1974, he comes back doing his research at the lock, has a heart attack. They're pulling him away on the stretcher, he notices that he goes right by the same exact spot where he saw this figure in black.
So the thing got him, in other words.
Well, maybe it was foreshadowing. I don't know. I don't know how to describe it. But
Switcherino, thanks very much. Ooh. Always educating and enlightening.
Yep. Well, another nightmare tonight. Yep.
Another nightmare tonight, guaranteed. Thank you, Switcherino, and we'll
My
talk.
My pleasure.
Yep. Everything's okay with you up there? I've already asked you that. I just want to make sure.
Everything's really good.
Excellent. Okay. So, Juan, pass me a note now. Hang on. Where are the pictures of your wife?
Oh,
from last week.
Oh, we haven't done that yet.
Oh, okay. All right. Please. Okay. He's signaling me now. Get to it.
And did we ascertain what your favorite breakfast cereal was besides donuts?
Besides donuts. Well, there's a cereal that are little donuts. It's called donuts.
I was told by my doctor I needed to.
I like frosted.
Don't believe that quack.
You got to get off the frosted mini wheats. So, that used to be my cereal of choice.
Yep. Well, I grew up with Wheaties. You know, Bob Richards, twice Olympic champion.
Wheaties. Oh, I like Wheaties as a kid. Yeah, yeah.
I go back and forth with Wheaties and shredded wheat, the big biscuits.
Shredded wheat is really good, but both of them you got to put a lot of sugar on.
That's true.
Anyway, Switcherino, thank you very much for joining us, and we will talk to you next week.
Right, sounds good.
Thank you, Switch.
Good night.
Good night.
And there he goes. Switcherino from...
Always scary.
Every week. Thank you very much, you know, because I'll be laying in bed saying, wow, you know, what is really happening out there? Anyway, why don't we take a commercial break now, and we'll be right back after this. You're listening to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files Show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. We'll be right back.
UFOs are found in Renaissance art, on ancient coins, and etched on cave walls. They're even reported in the Bible. But more surprising is when UFOs are seen the most, in times of war. Through centuries, thousands of UFO sightings have been made by high-ranking officials, military pilots, and ordinary soldiers. Often, these fantastic appearances occur at the height of great battles. From World War I to D-Day to Korea, Vietnam, and beyond, military investigators are baffled. Why do UFO sightings spike so drastically during wartime? Could it be mistaken aircraft, or is someone or something looking in on us? In UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, Mack Maloney chronicles centuries of these incredible sightings and tries to solve the puzzle of why so many UFOs are seen while humanity is at war. Read about the scare ships, the ghost planes, and the ghost rockets, alien giants in the jungles of Vietnam, UFOs controlling our ICBM bases, dogfights with flying saucers during the Gulf War, and more. 300 pages of unbelievable stories, along with many startling photographs. That's UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, by Mack Maloney. On sale at your local bookstore or on Amazon.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files Show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney. In the studio with us tonight, keeping one seat warm, the very famous UFO mechanic Al Rinaldo is here.
Hello, Mack.
Very simply dressed. And frankly, I appreciate the... I'm so dazzled by Juan's attire every week.
Well, he does cut a very sharp figure. I can't hope to to match him in that way.
Very smart not to compete with him.
No, I know my limits.
Just let him have the crown.
I'm not a fashionista. I'm not a clothes horse.
You're not a clothes horse. That happens to be the secret word of the night. For some reason, this isn't loud enough. Here we go. $10,000 for our special effects machine on the phone with us. Commander Cobra is here. Al, I just wanted to report to you that there are flashing red lights right outside the window here. Hopefully one of our cars is not aflame. Commander Cobra is on the line with us, right?
Good evening, gentlemen. You know, I haven't received the salute tonight. I'm a little concerned.
Wouldn't you know he'd be
Juan
the one
Juan
to.
Put the camera on. Right. It was so disturbing we didn't salute.
That's true. It kind of, went right through our... All right, so Al and I are actually saluting you. Oh, very sharp salute from Al. Wow.
I was criticized the last time because I gave too much of an English
Kind of the pansy salute there. But okay, he did a very American salute there. Okay.
Al, I'd like to put a term towards you. As we know, we refer to Juan-Juan as our metrosexual expert, subject matter expert on the show. I'd like to make you the mechanical.
Oh, I could be the Neanderthal, you know. I mean, more of the...
No, yes, it's your family for a friend there that was 7 feet tall and had testosterone treatments. That guy definitely...
Wow, that was definitely off air. Anyway, joining us, if he's still there, the very famous Switcherino Steve Ward up there in the Bowl of Flakes, Battle Creek, Michigan. How you doing there tonight, Switch?
Well, listen, I'm doing so good tonight that I have actually moved the good-bad scale over a couple notches. Wow. So bad isn't quite as bad anymore.
Wow. Once again, great name for a book. Bad isn't quite as bad anymore. I like that.
You could be a motivational speaker.
Yeah, right. Yes, he is. Well, he's like that anyway. He's always, I think it's still his best shtick, as we might say in the biz, was this close to awesome. No, what was it? Do you remember?
Beyond awesome?
Beyond I think it was like this close to awesome or almost awesome or something like that. I'll have to look it up. I'll go through the shows. But you're always very optimistic. Why are you optimistic? You live in Michigan. Why? Please tell us why.
Well, it's actually we're experiencing a heat wave. It was in the 40s today. So, you know, a January thaw. We'll get one of those.
We get them here in New England, but they're like sometimes they're like 60 degrees. They call them Indian winter. No,
summer.
What do they call them?
No, it's a January thaw.
January thaw, right. Yeah, right. Yeah.
We had one last week.
Right. We've had very strange weather here in New England, not to cut into a segment, but we've had almost no snow.
Right.
Knock on wood, right? Well, we've had almost no really frigid weather.
You can't get snow most of the time. I got 3.5 feet of snow sitting on my property. Come on.
Do you up there in undisclosed location number one?
Yes, up in Maine. That's correct.
Now, okay, we have a storm coming tonight, but they say on the coast it's supposed to just be rain.
Just rain. You know, we live right on the ocean, so you know, we don't get the snow as other people do. However, 2 years ago we got 15 feet of snow. So
yeah, that was pretty outrageous.
You can't count on.
Actually, just real quick, I noticed the other day it was almost 60 degrees.
Yep.
I have a hive of honeybees in my yard. The bees are out.
Really?
They were flying. I mean, normally you'd see them come out on the landing board when it warms up and they'll look around a little bit. Mm-hmm. These guys were flying.
What do they do during the winter? They hibernate?
They don't hibernate. They sort of form into a ball, and they can actually disjoint their wings a certain amount and use the muscles that would power their wings to generate heat.
Wow.
And the queen stays in the center. They make a ball around her. And they kind of
sounds like a bad night down the beach.
And they use the sugar, right? They use their honey and stuff.
Their honey is their food. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man. I love the honey.
So the problem is, though, when you take the honey supers off in the fall, you're taking their winter food. So you got to be really careful because there's a very fine line between taking what you need and leaving them enough to make the winter.
Right.
So you got to watch out because if you have a really bad summer and a really bad winter afterwards, then they can starve to death, and that happens more than you think.
Well, Al's nice enough to give us some of his honey sometime, and I know one time Mrs. Mack made honey cookies, man. They were very, very good.
Yeah, raw, fresh. Mm-hmm. It's not going to get any fresher. It's not going to get any more local because it's...
Between our two wives, we're lucky we're not like 300 pounds.
Oh, yeah, they're both always really baking or cooking something.
Good bakers. Yeah. Anyway, really off the subject. Let's go back up to the Bowl of Flakes. So, Steve, what do you have for us tonight?
Well, tonight I have what may be one of the first Men in Black encounters. Mm. Of course, we've heard of the Men in Black before, these strange figures that go around harassing UFO witnesses. Now, this takes place in 1924, and we're in Braxton County, West Virginia. Now, we have been there before when we talked about the Flatwoods Monster. The Flatwoods Monster was that famous sighting encounter back in 1952. Remember where the school children saw something land behind the hill? They went up there and saw this very strange creature or contraption or whatever. And it's just one of those things that have gone down to the annals of UFO lore. Well, and here's in 1924. Actually, John Keel came across this mm-hmm. story. When he was in that area at that time period, back in the 60s, he was investigating other creature sightings, UFO sightings, because as we know, West Virginia was a hotbed for all kinds of strange activity. Well, he encountered a gentleman named John Cole, who back in 1924 was a reporter in the area. And what happened was, this was near Jim, West Virginia, in Braxton County. There's several isolated farms out there. And a huge aircraft, very strange-looking aircraft, appeared in the sky. And it was jerking up and down and as if it was in some kind of distress. All of a sudden, it dipped down, and several witnesses saw it. It seemed to crash into the forest off in the distance somewhere. So several of the men got together, including this reporter, John Cole, and they went to go find to see where this thing crashed. Well, they encountered a farmer that actually saw it fall to the ground, and he described it as being as big as a battleship, and it didn't seem to have any wings. So the impression is it's kind of one of these cigar-shaped ships or something that we've heard so much about over the decades that people have reported. As you pointed out, Mac, that's one of the most common UFO sightings, mm-hmm. Descriptions of the craft. Okay. So they find this thing after searching for several hours, and they find it's landed or crashed in a clearing. And there's already several people there. Now, these people are maybe a little over 5 feet tall. There's about half a dozen of them. When they get a closer look at them, they have kind of Asian features Uh-oh. And dark skin.
Watch
now,
it.
That's, we've heard that before, too.
Yes.
Some of the men in black, I mean, men in black is a generic term. Sometimes it's used to describe people that say they are Air Force officers that confiscate photographs or, pester people about their sighting, tell them to shut up about it, to not tell anybody. But sometimes you get these descriptions of men that are have high cheekbones, slanted eyes, a dark countenance. Now, they were also wearing black business suits with ties. Mm. So that's the first thing that struck John Cole's, like, what the heck are these guys doing out in the middle of West Virginia, dressed like little undertakers.
So, well, if you had Juan-Juan on the show, he could give
exactly.
But anyway.
Now, a few of them also had shiny coveralls on. And when these guys first came up on them, they were kind of nervous. It's like they really didn't want to be seen. And especially the guys in coveralls kind of made themselves scarce. They also noticed these guys, when they walked up on them, that they were speaking in some kind of a foreign rapid-fire language, something they couldn't understand at all. So now this is, not too long after World War I. One of the guys got real nervous, and he raised his rifle and said, "They're spies." Mm-hmm. And so Cole said, "Oh, calm down. Put your gun down. Don't worry about it." So one of the men came forward and started talking to him. He spoke English just fine, but he said Cole said it was a very strange accent that he couldn't place. And he said that it's everybody's all right, nobody's hurt, and we're going to get to the go to the local sheriff and give him a full report. I said okay. Well, Cole figures they can get out of there. There's nothing, no laws have been broken, and so they thought they would just leave the in quotes foreigners to whatever they were doing to take care of their craft. Now, one thing Cole did, and this is classic, he saw a piece of the debris on the ground. Now, when he's talking to Keel, he didn't really describe what it looked like. He used the word that my grandparents used so often, some kind of a thingamajig. So he picks this thing up.
Secret word of the night,
unobserved,
by the way. Sorry.
And he sticks it in his coat pocket. Goes home. Mm-hmm. He lives nearby. And now this was 40 years after the fact. Like I say, Cole was 80, but he was very sharp, had his faculties. And like I say, Keel just stumbled onto this guy accidentally, just asking people various questions in the area.
We should explain to people who don't know, John Keel is a very famous author, wrote the Mothman Prophecies, and many other things. He's a very respected. He's like my favorite UFO author, if you want to call him that. Really good author. Someone who really does research. Not a lot of BS in his books. No BS in his books. Anyway, go ahead, please.
And he did a lot of research in this area, and we've talked about him numerous times before. Mm-hmm. Okay, so he goes home. It's about 3 a.m. He hears this knock on the door, and he gets up. And he goes to the door, and there's the guy standing there, as it's had got the classic World War One uniform on, you know, the wide brimmed hat. He's got the, you know, they had the kind of leggings.
Yeah, sure.
On their to cover their legs. Mm-hmm. And the guy says, "You know, you've got something that belongs to us that we want back." And he's a little bit befuddled. He's half asleep and everything. He says, "Oh," so he goes to his coat, pulls the thing out of the pocket, and he says, "Is this what you're talking about?" So the guy takes it, and he, without a word, turns around and walks away. Cole said it was kind of weird because he doesn't know how he got it in the first place. He didn't know that he was seen taking it. He didn't know how they found him, and. Also, this guy didn't seem to have any mode of transportation. There was no horse there. There was no kind of a vehicle where he would have pulled up. So for some reason, this guy's on foot. Hmm. And so and the other thing about this guy was he said when he looked at him, while he was a little bit taller than the men he saw out there in the clearing, he also had high cheekbones, slanted eyes, and what appeared to be dark skin. So it kind of freaked him out. He told Keel, he said, I was a reporter, but I figured I better not report this because maybe I, you know, trespassed on some kind of a government project or whatever, and I might get in trouble. So I just let it go.
Mm-hmm.
A few days later, he goes back and to the clearing and absolutely nothing's there. You know, it's classic. Everything's cleared out.
Mm-hmm.
Although the grass and the foliage and so forth is pressed down. I mean, something happened there. They weren't crazy. They didn't imagine it. He talked to a local farmer in the area who the day before said he saw some strange lights in the night sky the day before. And that was it. That was one of the early Men in Black mm-hmm. reporting. Keel also said that several years later he received a letter from a man from Oregon that relayed a similar incident. It occurred in the 1930s. There's not a lot of detail here, but a strange plane crashed. Some local farmers picked up some of the debris. And shortly thereafter, some, in quotes, army officers showed up and collected the debris, the souvenirs that they had collected. So this kind of thing had happened before, kind of a pattern.
Right. Let me just ask a question. I'm going to ask Cobra a question. Now, we're back in the 30s, right, Switch?
Yeah, well, this is the first one was in the 20s, and okay. This is the other one's the 30s.
So, I mean, before that, I mean, basically any kind of, let's say, top secret weapon that the Army Air Corps might have would be, you know, a biplane or something like that. But But then at one point we started to get into monoplanes, and I suppose that at some point, Cobra, right, a B-17 would be a secret weapon, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, and plenty of planes before that.
So people might see a B-17 might say, "Wow, look at this thing! This looks completely different than."
What about a dirigible
or a Zeppelin?
Zeppelin type ship.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that makes more sense because it's cigar shaped.
Right. Well, that's the first thing I thought of when he said cigar shaped was an airship.
Would blimps be? I suppose blimps would be considered top secret weapons. You know, in the '20s, right?
Well, to some degree. Yes, and it wouldn't have been blimps, it would have been dirigibles. So that's the rigid airship like the Hindenburgs and those kinds of airships. It's a very interesting scenario that plays up because I'm trying to think, well, why would they have had the accents that they did? Is this another country that's out, you know, scouting around? An airship is very susceptible to air currents being blown off course. You know, they weren't super powerful engines. They worked a lot of times with the airflow. So it's a very very intriguing scenario.
Right.
And of course, you know my fascination with the Men in Black It's amazing how the actual agents seem to show up, and then the ones that are impersonating them show up.
I'm just going to throw something in here. The scare ships of 1909 in Great Britain, basically what people saw were what, you know, they thought were Zeppelins, even though at the point in 1909, Zeppelins weren't flying any more than just on a tether over Germany. But people reported seeing these huge airships. They would go, they were clocked at more than 200 miles an hour. And people all over the British Isles saw them. And when they would show up, they would have huge searchlights beaming down at the ground, which is not what you want to do if you want to stay secret. And then at some point, pieces fell off of one of them on a cliff in England. And when the owner of the farm where these things actually fell went out and collected them, he saw men in black kind of hanging around looking for these things. Okay, so this is a story that we keep hearing all the time. You know, who are these men in black? I mean, these scare ships were not German. Everyone knows that. In fact, they asked Count von Zeppelin, right, did you have any Zeppelins flying over England in 1909? And he said, his reply was, I don't believe in ghosts, right, which I take as a no. But something was there. They took pictures of them and right, so on and so forth. But very intriguing that not only do these things show up, but men in black show up too, you know, with right, them, you know. So, and there were a lot of airship reports like in the late 1800s. In fact, close to where we live, Lynn, Massachusetts, there was a newspaper that actually took a picture of an airship flying over Lynn, of all places.
Wow.
Okay, they're probably trying to get out of Lynn, but that's another story. But, you know, there
you
were
airships. Like that's your guy.
Okay, hang on. Commander is demanding a rim shot. But people would see these things. They would see people in them. They would see people climbing down ladders from them. And at that time, there was no airships around that could, you know, do the things that these things did. So it almost sounds like one of these things.
We had them come over around 1897. There was a big flap of the airships. They came over Michigan and Indiana. Mm-hmm. Now, you had to be careful of some of those because occasionally a, in quotes, journalist would have a little fun and just, you know, spin a tale. Mm-hmm. But then you're right. They were out east. They were over California,
right,
Texas, and
right,
so
yeah,
forth.
And then over the British Isles and later on, and then over lots of Europe. So, and people never really figured out what was going on, and then what happened. Conveniently, World War One started, and people forgot about them and so on. But maybe this was the situation where it was one of these airships.
Could be.
Who knows? But it's intriguing, nevertheless. So, Switch, what's your what do you think it was? I'm going to throw the ball.
You know what? I don't know. I keep looking for patterns, and I don't always have answers. But it seems... It seemed like it's something not conventional. It almost lends to the idea of, you know, a hidden civilization, mm-hmm, or a hidden race or whatever. I mean, this is certainly all these incidents were very physical. I mean, we may call it paranormal, but it wasn't like they were dealing with apparitions or right, projections or holograms or
right,
whatever.
Right.
These events really happened.
I mean, sorry to interrupt you, but just go to the scare ships, the way that they tracked how fast they were going was at the time in England there were like, I don't know, like 40 newspapers, you know, and there were like 10 alone in London. So what these reporters did is they went to a village or a town where the scare ships showed up a lot, and they were on some kind of communication, telegraph, whatever, with people back in London, and they would spot the scare ship over this town, and then it would be spotted over London or near London, you know, like 20 minutes later, and then they would just kind of
interpolate
right, exactly. and speed. They figured out that these things were going like 200, 220 knots. And even today, a blimp, a mod blimp can only go about 50, 60 miles an hour, you know?
Yeah.
So whatever these things were. And it's interesting you bring up that this alternate civilization thing, which a lot of people have written about. When you look into the scare ships, you also look into the ghost flyers of 1934 over Sweden, and the ghost rockets over Sweden in 1946, you're almost seeing technology that is just a little bit more advanced than the time, okay? And with the ghost rockets in 1946, people thought they were captured German buzz bombs that the Russians were launching. They found out that that was not true. But a Swedish pilot actually rode alongside one of these things, and his description matches exactly a Tomahawk cruise missile from the 1980s. You know, sounds strange, but that's the truth. And it's almost like you are looking at technology that's just a little bit more advanced. It's like in the wrong place type thing, right. You know. Right. And this seems like another – and the airships of the 1880s and 90s in the United States, same thing. It's almost like, I don't know, alternate universe or, you know, some kind of a civilization up in the North Pole. Who knows? But there's no other explanation.
And also, a lot of these sightings seem to originate from the poles, Antarctica, and some of the supposedly some of the incidents where visits from the Men in Black showed up was when UFO researchers were trying to plot the course of some of these things and realizing they were coming from Antarctica and so forth. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden they'd get a knock on the door. One of these strangers would be asking them questions.
Right. In a story you did a couple of weeks ago, had UFOs just flying like, you know, really very high speed showing up, coming out of the North Pole region, showing up off of Miami, right?
Right.
That's very strange. I mean, these things happen. You don't hear about them often, but, you know, people like John Keel, who was a really respected UFO author, you know, documented these things. They do happen. You just can't put your finger on it. It's almost like you're just like a little bit away from some kind of a reasonable explanation, but, you know, what is it, you know? So
scary.
It's especially intriguing are the Men in Black connection, or what we call Men in Black. Mm-hmm. Some of those incidents are, you know, the simple idea of an Air Force officer or a secret group showing up, even that doesn't quite explain it. There's a real odd, even almost a very negative, or some people look at it as a modern day, oh, I don't know, a modern day devil theory almost. Mm-hmm. Something very negative, something very paranormal.
It's kind of strange that this has been like a common theme. I mean, way before we got into any of these things that might be conspiracy theories run by the government or whatever, you see a very, some people see a very strange thing, something very strange happen, something very strange in the sky, and then the Men in Black always kind of show up. Napa Know
How! There are lots of amazing cars on the road, but perhaps none more amazing than the paid-off car. It may not be pretty, but the price is right. Heck, if you keep that thing running, it'll actually start paying you. Because with Napa Rewards, for every $100 you spend, you'll get $5 off. So keep your car running longer, stronger with Napa Rewards and watch the savings start rolling in. That's Napa Know-How. Napa Know-How!
We were talking about last week how back in the Dark Ages when people, you know, there was the Black Plague and all that, all these crazy things are going on. People would see Men in Black, and it turns out that those are the people that now we refer to as the Grim Reapers, you know?
Right.
So this whole...
And sometimes... In the modern day report, somebody would there was a classic one in England with, that Jenny Randall's covered, where a young lady saw some kind of a strange craft, didn't report it to anybody, but yet within a couple of days, a couple of men that appeared to be from the government showed up asking her questions about it. Mm-hmm. And it was such a weird situation where in the first place, her parents didn't really even understand why they let these guys in without any questioning, but they came in. This one guy was firing questions at her. She was very distressed. Later on, Jenny Randall's had the idea to put this lady under regressive hypnosis, as they do with many UFO witnesses. Mm-hmm. And they found out that while this one guy was firing questions at her, the other individual at least seemed to her to be asking her questions telepathically, ooh, alternately to the guy that was asking her questions verbally.
Wow.
Now, if that isn't weird,
trying
and
to
creepy,
confuse her.
What
that's,
is?
That's out there, yeah.
Switcherino, thank you very much for this fascinating report. What's new with you up there in the, or have I already asked you that?
Just the weather. I found out I've got 4 days of vacation I've got to use up.
Wow.
So that's kind of exciting.
I mean, use up until
well, I'm when? Supposed to use it up by the 15th, but they're going to let me carry it over. And so I'm thinking about another trip down to Point Pleasant.
Oh, down to where the Mothman, yep.
Where the Mothman originated from.
Now, do you drive down there? Or do you fly?
I drive down. It's only from South Central Michigan. It's only about, 6-7 hours, depending mm-hmm. on how many stops.
Right.
If I leave right from work, it's only about 5.5 hours. So
well, you
I just
could be,
go
you could be like that female,
Ohio.
You'd be like that female astronaut, remember? She drove from Houston to Miami and she wore adult diapers.
Oh, man.
She didn't have to
stop. I don't know if that's in good taste considering that we're talking about Gene Cernan, and then you have to bring up that crazy woman. Unbelievable.
Sorry about that.
Well, I could use that, the same kind of, what, depends? Is that what she had on?
Yes.
It would save some time.
Depends. Secret word of the week. Depends. It depends. Switchblade,
so
thank you very
is
much.
Is that
for
the secret recipe for a good vacation?
What?
A pack of Depends.
There you go, pack and a lot of Red Bull.
At this point in time, I'd rather just make the stop, you know, and maintain my dignity.
Well, if you go down there, please, do a report for us. When is the big Mothman Festival?
September, always the third weekend in September.
Okay.
Which we'll have to do a show on that again, because that's anybody that is even remotely interested in any aspect of the paranormal, that's the place to go. Mm-hmm. It's informative. It's a blast. Do we have a couple minutes yet?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to say one of the co-founders of the Mothman Festival, Carolyn Harris, mm-hmm. she co-founded the festival with Jeff Wamsley, who runs the museum. She just passed on recently. She was in her 70s. She ran the Harris Steakhouse, which is otherwise known as the Mothman Restaurant. And
I can think of a better name, but go ahead, please.
Well, that was just everybody knew it was the Mothman, right? Mothman Diner.
Can you imagine what the specials that must be Mothman on the menu? Diner. The team.
Oh yeah, there's some pretty good ones. But she was such a great lady, she actually her husband and infant child were two of the people that died on the bridge. Collapse that happened after the Mothman fiasco back in December of '67, was very much into turning, something that people perceive as a negative into a positive. Mm-hmm. And walking into her restaurant was like walking into your mom's kitchen at home. Mm-hmm. Just a great lady. And they think somebody else is going to buy the restaurant and kind of keep it going.
Okay.
But she was definitely going to be missed. And just a really, really, really super person.
Well, it's too bad to hear that, but I'll say this again. We've said it many times on the show. If anyone out there is just coming to this kind of whole UFO paranormal type thing, if you really want to read, in my opinion, the incident that has like the most evidence, the most eyewitnesses, and is the strangest thing in the world, just read John Keel's The Mothman Prophecies. It's one of the most researched books on paranormal, and it's impossible that it's all made up. There's no noise involved with this, okay? People saw this thing. It's very strange, and there was a tragedy with the bridge collapsing. It just seems to, have happened close to when people were seeing this very strange figure. It's just a great story. So if you're just new to the table, go out and buy The Mothman Prophecies by John Keel, right? Would you agree there, Switcherino?
Absolutely. And actually, anything by John Keel, there's never been more of his writings that have been republished. Several anthologies of his articles, and you can gauge his he changed his ideas like so many of us do over a period of time, over the decades.
Right.
But it can also get some of his stuff on Audible. So, do a lot of driving or whatever, and it's one creepy book to listen on Audible. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I couldn't wait for it to come out when it finally did back in mid-70s, I guess.
Right. John Keel, K-E-E-L. K-E-E-L, John Keel.
Yeah, just to check out his name on Amazon, and Amazon's also part of Audible. There's a wealth of good stuff there to get into.
Right. Thank you, Switcherino, for joining us tonight.
Over the years, Air Force Major Hawk Hunter and his band of patriotic fighter pilots have fought tirelessly to reunite a fractured America, devastated by a Russian sneak attack. Now, returning from a mysterious space odyssey, Hunter finds a huge Russian army occupying New York City, ready to invade the rest of America. Buzzing through the city's skyscraper canyons in a tiny top-secret ghost plane, and seeing the invaders' massive weaponry for himself, Hawk realizes he's up against the greatest danger his homeland has ever faced. But equally alarming are reports claiming that Hawk's former girlfriend, Dominique, is living with the head of the Russian secret police in a Manhattan penthouse. Is she his prisoner, or is she something else? With the woman and the country he loves in dire peril, Hawk Hunter, the wingman, will apply all his aviation prowess to launch the most crucial battle for America yet, no matter what the risks. Filled with fast-paced action, a wide range of aircraft and military hardware, Battle for America brings back your favorite characters from earlier books in the Wingman series and delivers a riveting story that reveals new insight on America's most famous hero, the Wingman. That's Wingman 18, The Battle for America, on sale now at Amazon.com and available at your local bookstore.
Hey, Juan-Juan, did you go to the beach a lot as a kid?
Yes, Mac, I sure did.
I have a feeling like as a youth you were like the 90-pound weakling and that the bullies used to kick sand in your face.
As a matter of fact, they did. I mean, I tried to pump iron back then, but I'd get pooped pretty quickly.
Oh, my God. Look at you two girly men.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
What are you doing here?
I'm here to make sure you read the ad copy for this fabulous new workout product called SEX that I can't endorse, but I'm sure works wonderfully.
Hey, Arnold, what was that thing with you and the maid?
Ugh, just do the ad.
Yeah, man, nailing the maid, that's a little fringy.
That's it. I'm going to turn you into two Vienna pretzels.
Cobra, save us!
I'd be glad to, gentlemen. What the boys are trying to say is, this is a new energy drink that can give you the extra endurance you need to get through your daily workout.
Yeah.
It's called SEX, for Strength Energy Accelerator. It comes easy to use. Just mix a scoop with water and drink 30 minutes before you start your workout, and you find you can last longer and feel all around better after finishing your regime.
Yeah.
The mix comes in many different flavors. Of course, my favorite is passion fruit.
Me too.
And it contains all the essentials you need to get over the top, whether you're trying to add muscle and bulk or just maintain your current physique.
You could look like me.
That's SEX, workout dietary supplement, available only through Cadillo USA. Visit CadilloUSA.com for more details. That's CadilloUSA.com and get some sex today.
Hey, what's going on in here?
Pistol Pete,
what are you doing here?
I told you guys, no partying in the studio. What are all these dumbbells doing here?
Hey, just because you own this place doesn't mean you can call me a dumbbell.
Oh, yeah?
Kick his ass, Pete.
Come on, I'm right here.
SEX workout powder, available only through CadilloUSA.com. Read instructions carefully before using.
I'm Arnold Schwarzenegger. Hear me now and listen to me later. Now here's Mac.
Welcome back, everyone, to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight. Very famous and very handsome Juan-Juan.
Thank you. With my red argyle socks.
Right. He's some reason earlier in the show, he demanded that we call him Mr. Handsome tonight.
I think it's from here on out.
Right. Yeah. What, a negotiating ploy? Is it a ploy or is it?
It's a new contract requirement with Juan-Juan.
Wow. Anyway, and Commander Cobra is also here, and we have saluted him already.
Yes, and it was already rated.
Okay. All right.
Let's just move on.
Okay. All right. Well, no.
He said it was getting better.
No, what started was you gave him a great salute. You gave attention, and he complimented you.
It was a more crisp salute.
Right, and I'm just like barely, right. Going up to the bar.
And then it starts,
10 minutes
later. Oh, by the way, I want to be referred to as handsome. I mean, it's not, there's something not right there. Let's not go into it. Let's just move on.
It is out of control here. But anyway, to bring us all back to reality, on the phone with us is our friend Switchblade Steve Ward up there in Battle Creek, Michigan. How are you doing there tonight, there, Switchy?
I am doing really good tonight.
Wow. What was that?
Banana
bomb?
Steve reached right through the microphone and pulled my head into it.
Okay. All right. That was like that.
It sounded like a golf ball fell out of his hand.
Anyway, okay. Just more of the fun here on Mack Maloney's Military Exile show. Steve, how are you doing tonight?
Beyond wonderful.
Beyond wonderful. That would be the title of your biography, right? Or your autobiography?
Or my epitaph. What's
beyond wonderful. Yeah, beyond
all
wonderful.
Three.
He was beyond wonderful. Now he's just beyond.
Boy,
anyway.
That was a downer on his epitaph.
Okay. Yeah, I know.
Are you writing it already?
Once again.
No.
Someone's sucking the funny right out of the
room. I think that you could also put that right above what W.C. Fields said. I'd rather be here than in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Okay. That's right. In W.C. Fields' last film.
Oh, I know this trivia. Keep going.
Who plays the bartender?
Damn, I do
it's,
know.
It's this. The one where he says, not the Philadelphia one, but something about kids. He's, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's, anyway. It's a classic.
Shemp.
Yep. From the.
Really?
Yeah, Shemp. It was. Just, he's like.
Shemp Howard.
Yeah, Shemp Howard. Yep. He's like the second, you know, billing on the movie.
Yep.
Anyway, W.C. Fields drank a little bit. You know that?
I've heard that he tipped a couple in his day.
Anyway, Switch. So let's get back to you. Your biography would be. What was it? Simply
his
Wonderful?
His epitaph.
No, Beyond Wonderful.
All three.
Beyond Wonderful.
Beyond Wonderful. Okay.
And
all
then
right,
you had to add that he's now Beyond.
Anyway. So I was told off air by our staff that you have a clown-related story to start off with.
Well, I just said I had some more information.
Either way.
It preceded the weird clown stuff that was going on. You know, remember we talked about Lauren Coleman, how he found that this stuff was happening all over the U.S., not just in Boston in 81.
Right.
Well, the thing that kind of seemed that, well, and maybe it was connected, maybe not, but at a place called Mineral Point, Wisconsin, in March of that year, an entity that they called the Vampire was running around. This guy had his face was painted all white, not quite like a clown, wore a cape. And was scaring the hell out of people. And it was a little bit like, remember the reports of Spring Heel Jack?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite monster.
Kind of, there's some vague similarities in some of these things.
Wow.
So I just thought it was interesting that kind of kicked off everything.
If it was a guy in white with a cape running around, I go and arrest every, like, English teacher. And within, you know what I mean? Like, you know, they all have capes, you know that. Within a 30-mile radius.
I just remember back to the days of the Kiss Army. Obviously, I'm showing my age. There was quite a bit of that going on. Yeah. So,
I mean,
they made a career out of it. Why can't the man in Wisconsin?
Wow. Well, hey, maybe he's trying. Yeah. You never know.
All right, I'm keeping a strict rule. What is your next piece, Steve?
Yes. Okay. I'm fascinated by the fact that people are going out not just to be hooligans, but dressing up as clowns and then being hooligans.
Yeah, now we have clown vampires to add to the clown karma. Perfect. Steve, your next item, please, sir. The Hills. You had an update on the Hills that you wanted to talk about in the aftermath.
Well, I thought maybe we could say that for another time. It would take a little bit of time, and there's quite a bit to talk about on the whales story.
Okay.
Promised.
All right. Well, we got to roll.
Go.
Okay.
The name of the place in Wales was?
It's a county. It's actually... it's not there anymore. It's broken up into three different counties. But it was back then in 1977. It was called Dyfed, and it's spelled D-Y-F-E-D. Okay. And these strange events are chronicled in a great book called The Dyfed Enigma by Randall Pugh and F.W. Holliday.
Mm-hmm.
F.W. Holliday was a great researcher into the Loch Ness Monster.
Okay.
His first book chronicled it. He thought it was a flesh and blood animal. His second book, called The Dragon and the Disc, he pursued a paranormal aspect.
Oh,
very
wow.
Interesting.
Yeah, right.
Great researchers.
Hmm.
But what happened here was this particular case, on the surface, it seems like almost like an E.T. invasion.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of bizarre things going on.
Right.
But everything you can imagine was going on in this area. Poltergeist phenomena, religious apparitions, a strong, what I call, Magonia connection, like, via Jacques Vallée, Passport to Magonia.
Oh, right.
Connections
sure.
with the little people,
yep.
similarities to that, the folklore. So one of the first events that occurred was around a school.
Excuse me, did we say what year this was and date and everything?
Yes. Yeah, 1977.
Okay, 77,
In southwest Wales.
And the month again was?
Month was February. February the 4th is the first first incident that occurred.
It's dank and rainy and cloudy and miserable and so on.
Go ahead. It's the Broadhaven middle school. There was kind of a swampy area out back. Now, some of the children, when they're out in recess, they spotted this egg-shaped object in a field. And there were several of them that saw this. So they went in, told the headmaster. Headmaster thought, kids are just playing a prank.
Mm-hmm.
But later on, in the days that followed, other teachers saw this thing in the distance. Now, Randall Pugh, that's spelled P-U-G-H, by the way.
Yes.
He got onto this right away. Now, all the people that they interviewed during these several months were firsthand witnesses. They didn't take any secondhand accounts or whatever. But he went and he interviewed these children. Some of them saw some kind of a man, some kind of a humanoid figure near this craft. Now, this is off in the distance. There's kind of a stream and then a swampy field on the other side where you couldn't really drive a vehicle back there. They couldn't have mistaken, you know, something else for being back there.
Right.
One of the children that gave the best description was named Michael Webb. Now, his father, Tim Webb, he was an RAF officer. And so they interviewed him. He was a squadron leader also. His father believed his son implicitly. He said, I absolutely believe him. And he said something very interesting. He said, I've never seen a UFO myself, but I think it has something to do with the supernatural or paranormal.
Hmm.
Now, that's an odd thing for somebody to say back in 1977.
Right.
I mean, people like John Keel and Jacques Vallée had published, and that idea was out there. But, you know, even today, people immediately think, you know, E.T., aliens, and
right.
When we're dealing with material.
Right. When we talk about it on the show a lot, the United Field Theory of the Paranormal,
Unified.
Is it? Unified.
So, and we're really going to see it here in this instance.
And you know, all different kinds, everything, Loch Ness, ghosts, UFOs, all wrapped up in the same thing. I think it'd be fascinating if they could prove that someday. Go ahead, please, Steve.
Now, a few of these children thought they saw some kind of a figure moving around by this egg-shaped craft that landed back in the swamp. Okay, go ahead. Now, in about April is when a lot of things hit the fan. Tuesday, April 19th. In a place called Little Haven. Now, this is right on near the shoreline, near the ocean. And it was at the Haven Fort Hotel and owned by a Mrs. Granville. Now, she had got this hotel up and running for a while. It had a reputation as being haunted.
Yes.
Like a lot of these, you know, UFO sites, there's also the paranormal connection.
Right, yes.
It was supposed to be haunted by a lady in white. That was one of the attractions to this area.
All right.
Well, for a couple nights, she'd been buzzed by some kind of a strange blue light overhead.
Happened. Been there.
And,
done that.
And
go
then,
ahead, please.
And then one night, she hears, she's doing her dishes by the window. She hears a humming noise. Her radio quits. She looks outside and sees a couple figures walking in the distance. She gets her binoculars and she sees these two approximately 7 foot tall humanoids dressed in silver suits. She called them boiler suits, was what her point.
Napa know-how.
There are lots of amazing cars on the road, but perhaps none more amazing than the paid off car. It may not be pretty, but the price is right. Heck, if you keep that thing running, it'll actually start paying you. Because with Napa Rewards, for every $100 you spend, you'll get $5 off. So keep your car running longer, stronger with Napa Rewards and watch the savings start rolling in. That's Napa know-how.
Napa know-how!
The reference
was. They went to the Harlem Globetrotters, were they? Because they used to wear those silver suits.
Well, the thing is that she described their limbs, their arms and legs as long, almost like a gibbon. So there was something definitely, you know, not just the height, but something definitely strange about these two characters.
Yeah. They did not look like they were from Wales, is what we're really
No, definitely not.
All right, go ahead.
Possibly
and
Harlem.
Then, so the next day, the researchers went out there to check out the area. Now, this may have no connection, but there was an old structure there by the sea. A visible shaft in it, air vents and so forth.
Hang on.
Yes?
Did you say the secret word?
Yes, shaft. Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Oh, man.
Continue.
It had long been abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
It turned out it had at one time belonged to the Ministry of Defense. This was one of those bases for the Royal Observer Corps.
Oh, yeah,
sure. World War II.
Yep.
But, of course, long since abandoned and not used. So maybe no connection, but it was just interesting that they found landing marks of some kind of craft in that area as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this place, I mean, this everything was going on in this area. a guy named Searle John. This is also in April. He wakes up early one morning. There's a pulsating orange light outside the window. You know, it's almost like these guys weren't trying to stay hidden. It's like, hey, mm-hmm. we're here. You know, we're shining
right,
lights.
Right, yeah,
in your
we're
windows.
Not hiding.
Come and, come and look at us. Yep. So he looks out the window. He sees this classic egg-shaped craft up in the air, kind of moving back and forth like a pendulum. But that's not the weird part. The weird part is one of these seven-foot-tall humanoids is standing next to the craft. I say standing mm-hmm. loosely. But suspended in the air, as if he has just stepped outside this thing
oh, wow.
and is completely suspended in the air. Mm. Now, I want to make a comparison here. I'm going to go back 10 years earlier, Point Pleasant, West Virginia, in the midst of all the Mothman stuff. John Keel's famous book, obviously, mm-hmm. The Mothman Prophecies.
Right.
He describes an event that happened over the Point Pleasant High School. A woman he calls Mrs. Kelly went to go pick up her children. She looks up in the air, excuse me, sees an egg-shaped craft. Standing next to it outside is a tall figure dressed in a silver suit. No helmet this time, but humanoid looking with long hair.
Wow.
This character is looking down at her children as they're approaching the car. When she looks up again, he disappears.
Huh.
Now, from her point of view, she looked at it in a completely religious context.
Mm-hmm.
How so?
Just one of the many bizarre things that happened.
She thought it was a miracle. She thought there were angels or something.
She thought it was an angel, right?
I think she looked at it in some kind of an angelic context, maybe looking over her children.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Hmm. So, and when was the Mothman? What are the dates of the Mothman?
That was 66, 67.
Okay, and now we're talking about 10 years. But we're talking about something that happened in Wales.
It's 10 years later.
10 years later. Okay, but it's so strange that people see like the exact same things. It happens a lot.
Yep.
It happens a lot. Okay, go ahead, please, Steve.
Now, here we're going to get into some of the what I call the Magonia connection. They interviewed, like I say, they interviewed all kinds of people, first-person accounts. They were talking to a brother and sister that had some kind of a UFO encounter. And it turned out the youngest sister, who was about 8, spoke up and said she had a strange encounter one night, sees the flashing light through the window, looks outside, sees the classic egg-shaped spaceship. But instead of a 7-foot-tall humanoid, there's this tiny man standing on the windowsill with long hair, slanted eyebrows, and a curved nose. Now, what does that sound like?
That's Irish.
Leprechaun.
Okay, go ahead, please.
This is the White family. Their dog started whimpering.
I don't think we had to go there, Steve. We understand it's Wales.
Right, what's Wales? Go ahead, please.
Oh, you mean their last name is White. Is that with the...
We don't know. We'll never know. Okay. Go ahead.
There was a lot of animals were affected by these close encounters. This dog wouldn't sleep alone in the kitchen at night anymore. There was another woman, Mrs. Bassett. She saw some kind of a strange blue flashing light as she's driving home. She described it was kind of surrounded by some kind of an amorphous cloud. Okay, when she came home, her 3 Springer Spaniels were nowhere to be found. Hmm. 2 of them eventually showed up. Finally, the third one did. The third one never recovered, would never want to be alone. You'd had to literally drag him, a poor dog named Jasper. You had to drag him outside to actually go outside. Ah. So there were many instances they chronicled like this.
Right.
And now things are going to turn a little darker, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Young man named Mark Marsden, age 12. Now, I guess there isn't much to do he lived in a little place, a little village called Herbranston. Mm-hmm. And he and his buddies were out looking for bird's nests. You know, I guess that's what you do in Wales.
Wow, that must be really bored.
Or it could be code.
It could be code for, right, yeah, exactly. For
out looking for bird's nests.
I don't think there's any code here.
Yeah, out looking for bird nests. Please continue switching.
Okay, anyway. So he gets separated from his buddies, and he hears this heavy breathing. You see this 10-foot, or rather 7-foot, tall humanoid jumps out of the bushes, dressed again. He called it a boiler suit. Now, in all these cases, nobody ever said anything about a visor. They never saw a face or any facial features.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This thing started chasing him. So he runs to the gate of his farm, turns around, sees this thing has stopped. It's standing right underneath a street light, so he can get a really good look at it. Then he hightails it back to the farm, totally freaked out. Pugh and Holiday said this kid was, struck them as being a very hardy kid, not easily frightened. But this kid was just absolutely terrified by what happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then remember we talked about these things peering in windows.
Right.
A postmaster named Josiah George had one of these guys all of a sudden look in his window.
Wow, that's scary. You know what I mean? I mean, just that kind of element of all of a sudden the thing is looking in at you.
Jean Huber's, her two daughters were pursued, they said, by a green orb. It disappeared into the ground. Okay, things are going to get weirder now. The Ripperston Farm, the Coombs family. They saw these humanoid figures, I guess, a few different times. One night, they saw one of these. They called it a football-shaped object. It was the next day. They were cattle farmers. They had 100 cattle locked and tied in the pen. That night, they disappeared and ended up a half mile away at the Broadmoor farm.
That's so weird.
Now, yeah. Now think about
in
that.
In order for that to happen, somebody had to come in, unlatch the gate, run them by the house, and this wasn't a straight shot to the farm. Like they would just wander off by themselves.
Right.
They actually had to go off at a 90-degree angle to get there.
And how many cows were there?
In this particular instance, 100.
Okay, so you would hear 100 cows going by your
house. Oh, absolutely.
What are aliens trying to say? If you're an alien and you're moving cows a half a mile.
You're saying we can be quiet.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
And they have the technology to elevate.
He came up with that answer very quickly, didn't he? That's almost like a little bit too quick.
They're wicked smart.
Yeah, okay.
You know?
Well, according to the researchers, they dug into the past, and there was a legend of dairy maids. They would their goats would get out of their locked pens.
Dairy maids.
Dairy maids. You mean the
women who like actually milk the cows?
Yes, that would be virginal girls milking cows and goats.
Come on.
And the good people or the little people would say, "Our food is being spoiled," so that's why they moved their goats out of there. Pugh and Holiday theorized that they checked. There's a lot of magnetic anomalies in this area, and they mm-hmm. think a lot of this might have to do with electromagnetic fields.
Right.
And their hypothesis was that food might have been something to do with the energy supplied at some of these spots. I mean, they're just going out on a limb, but mm-hmm. but it's just interesting that you've got this weird parallel with traditional folklore and stuff that's going on.
Right. And how long did this whole thing last?
About not even quite a year.
Okay, but it was a pretty active year, though, right? If I remember the story right. I mean, stuff was happening all the time. But
they had, go ahead.
I was going to say, why there? You know what I mean? Is there anything there that's anything?
I never saw a map of these magnetic fields. They talked a little bit about ley lines, LEY.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. A lot of rumored salt lines, and, there's a lot of ancient stuff that goes on.
Yeah, a lot of ancient stuff over there. There's no doubt.
And the formations.
Why Point Pleasant, and really, the activity, there's still some things that happen in Point Pleasant, but not to that level. And this apparently hasn't had that same level. So I don't know why, but there's a tradition of some religious apparitions that happened before this.
Much like the Native American stuff that goes on in the United States, this part of the Isles has a lot of legend and lore that goes on going back to the original Celt and Welsh settlers that were there and the tribes that were living there. Mm-hmm. It's an amazing spot. And I know a lot of the popular culture kind of B-movies in Britain center around these woods with things like Wakewood and the werewolf movies. There's a lot of stuff that goes on there because it's a very, no pun intended, very fertile ground for this stuff that goes on. And up until just recently, I mean, they talk about the UFO crash in 1974 at Berwyn Mountain like it was an airplane crash. Mm-hmm. I mean, most of the people there don't seem to have a lot of issue talking about it in those terms.
Yeah.
Now, I once had to put together a history of strange things that have gone on in England over the years. And, I was told it was going to be 2 pages. It was like 22 pages. Every kind of weird, strange thing that has ever happened. Man, it's happened in England. It's incredible.
And the mix of UFOs, supernatural, the banshees, the leprechauns, the bad ones, the good ones, all that stuff is there. It's just, and it extends all through that region, all the way to Ireland, up north into Scotland. It's
strange.
It's got to be some magnetic fields in the Earth's crust,
something,
or plates shifting together, and
but it just seems like the more ancient a place is, like the stranger it is, you know. I mean, you know, people don't think about England as actually being in the Roman Empire for like 300 years.
Mm. Well, that's where the word London comes from, because London is the term that they used for their armory, their fortress. That they
put
their
really? Yeah, that's what, oh, wow. There's a little British humor for you there, history for you there, Juan-Juan.
He's quite cultured.
He is quite cultured. Yep. Anyway.
By the by.
Switch. So what was the, you know, at the end of the day, what, I mean, did anyone, how can you explain it? But, I mean, it was just such a strange story that all this stuff happened to happen in this one kind of isolated, average place.
Well, I was going to make a mention of this displacement. A few days later, they put 16 heifers into a pen because they wanted to get the milk machines ready. Left them for 4 minutes.
I've seen this movie. I'm sorry. Really?
They were gone completely. They just weren't in some other location.
Well, they went again to the Broadmoor farm. Okay. They were displaced to that one area.
Wow.
Pauline Combs, the woman that on this farm, before they moved there, they were living in just a trailer, and they saw a religious apparition of a woman dressed in white with a veil like a nun. Okay. Carrying a rosary. This is up in the air. She transforms into a vision of Jesus. This happens several nights in a row, seen by hundreds of people. And they're experiencing poltergeist phenomena in their trailer.
Wow.
I've got to have time to get to the big finish, so go ahead and...
big finish.
No, go big finish. Go big finish.
Okay, yep. Big finish. Okay.
All right.
Mid-October, all right?
Okay.
This is still going on. Pauline Combs, same lady. She's driving with her children to Broadhaven. They see this apparently a craft zipping through the sky. Now, a lot of these instances are very similar to stuff that happened in this, you know, at the Skinwalker Ranch in Utah.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Okay. She sees now. There's these huge rocks that come up out of the ocean called stack rocks, and if you Google them and see them, they're really magnificent.
It is. It's
amazing. They see what it looks like. A door or some kind of an opening open in the rock. This craft goes into it. Oh. The door shuts.
Excellent.
And then shortly after, they see a couple of these humanoids on top. It looks as if they're climbing up out of a stair. And then they're looking around, and then they go away.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
Now, here's the second part of the big finish.
Okay.
You figure, okay, you've got an RAF station there, right? Group Captain Brian Lemon. As the commanding officer,
Brian Lemon,
at the NATO base there.
Yes.
So the researchers go and say, "Hey, listen, you know, we've had all kinds of credible people have reported this strange UFO activity. Has your radar picked up anything?" Well, apparently, in 1977 in Wales, they weren't worried about Nazis, commies, or terrorists because they would turn their radar on at 6:30 a.m., leave it on for about 12 hours, and then shut it off for the night.
Oh.
So the invading alien hordes could come in at their leisure at night and invade.
That's Wales. A very interesting observation, though, why that would be not on all the time, not manned all the time. Very interesting.
I still don't follow it, but you know, I get it. It is a big finish. It was actually a double finish.
A double finish, right.
I do have one thing I want to add. Hopefully, this technically, I can get this to work. Steve, Switchblade, I need you to listen to this. Okay, that is in Welsh, and it's translated into, "Have you seen the UFO, and do you know where my cow is?"
Oh, wow.
I just wanted to add that cultural language.
now you're going to have to play it again so people will know.
A little Rosetta Stone, you know, from Mack Maloney's military. One more
now,
time.
Now, see, that was the big finish.
Yeah, oh, okay. One more time.
All right, there we go. All right.
Excellent. And the Welsh language word for UFO is UFO.
Interesting. Yeah. It's the shortest. Aren't they the ones that have like really long words
they
or
do.
Something?
Yeah. And it's very, very lyrical. Gaelic and Welsh, that particular, very, very lyrical, very pretty language.
I just can't imagine that place being anything but just dreary all the time.
Oh, I disagree completely. No. I think it's a phenomenally gorgeous place. Absolutely gorgeous place.
Oh, hey, Switch. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Oh, my pleasure.
Everything okay up there in Conflictville?
It's beyond wonderful.
Beyond wonderful.
Although we did have a clown report over in northeast of Detroit.
You know what? He's booking. Wait, he's booking.
At a car wash.
Detroit. At a car wash.
A car wash.
A car wash.
Well, that's really unusual.
And what was the activity of the clown at the car wash?
Well, the photograph I saw, he's just standing there hanging out. So
like someone who worked there. Yeah,
maybe he wipes down your window after you're done.
I'll never wash my car again because one clown's been spotted. Anyway, well, thanks for that. Clown report to put a period at the end of your sentence.
Yep. Boom.
And we'll see you next week.
All right. Sounds good.
Switchblade. Steve Ward. Up
see
there
later, Switch.
Battle Creek, Michigan, you know, where they make all the cereals. Everything. Every cereal in the world is made up there, as it turns out. Post, Kellogg's.
At least all the ones that matter.
Right, right.
I wonder if they've had a cornflakes explosion, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Let's not be joking about the cornflake explosion. Yeah,
hey, well, you guys, come on.
A lot of intensity here tonight. A lot of intensity.
Yeah, a lot of kind of bad vibes in the room.
It's because he has to be the handsomest person in the room. You know, like his good looks weren't enough that we had to acknowledge it once again.
Now we're at the bottom of that black hole, and there's the socks again.
The socks are being shown again.
Well, that's it, Juan-Juan. That's the show.
Wow, I'm exhausted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
a lot going on.
For some reason, yes. We're going to have to drone our sorrows somewhere.
I could have more fun like Rob and Switch.
They do have a lot of fun.
Commander. I got to get out in the field.
There's something about, you know, roaring through the
desert.
Can
I co-host from the field? Yeah, I get. Yeah.
And the seeing the stars and all that stuff.
I know it. Yeah. Who knows what you're going to see when you're staring at the stars?
That's what I mean.
I was looking at the full moon the other night, and I'm going, I thought I saw something cross the full moon, but it was going up and kind of stopped, and then, you know.
Really?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
It was the leaves on the tree, a branch.
Oh, really?
Kind of
out. Oh, okay.
You know,
all right. Hey, maybe
kind
it
of
was
a rogue branch, and it kind of cut my line of sight, and
wow,
was
okay.
Creating a.
But that was, maybe that was nature's way of sending you a message about
yeah.
something.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
Which is
it was
get stronger
get
glasses.
Then get to bed.
Yeah. Go to bed tomorrow. Yeah. You don't get 350 right. glasses. Anyway, okay. Juan, thank you very much for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you for having me.
Okay. Thank you, Captain. I mean, Commander Cobra out there in the Nevada desert. Thank you to Rob Beckhausen of War Is Boring. Thank you, Switchblade Steve. And thank to our guest tonight. His name was
Bill William
Weiskauver.
Weiskauver.
And the name of his book is Resurrection, An American Journey. Hey, listen, this is Mack Maloney for the whole gang saying we'll join you next week. Or we hope you join us next week. Until then, be safe, be happy, and
keep on trucking. And bye-bye.
Progressive presents Mind Flowness with Flo.
You are a mighty fortress of supreme knowledge. Progressive Direct has not only revealed their rates, but those of their competitors. If you were any more in the know, you would be drowning in, you know, the know.
Compare Progressive Direct rates with competitors' rates, because knowledge is power. Visit Progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates. Comparison rates not available in all states or situations. Prices vary based on...